Good evening and welcome to tonight's edition of Insight. I am your host, Pat Gagliardo. Tonight, during the first half of the show, we will explore the mystery of the near-death experiences with an expert on the subject. Plus, we will take your phone calls. I invite and welcome your questions and your comments. And as the show continues, I'm sure that you will be enlightened, educated, and entertained. And then during the second half, I will intuitively, through the paranormal means, answer your questions. And remember, you can continue to write to me in care of Insight, Post Office Box 425, Jewett City, Connecticut, 06351. Please include a photo, a self-addressed stamped envelope, and up to two questions. I will answer the mail right here on Insight. Tonight, my guest is a professor of psychiatry at the UConn Medical Center, and he is the author of The Near-Death Experience, Dr. Bruce Greyson. Welcome, Dr. Greyson, and thank you for coming to the show.
Thank you, Pat. Pleased to be here.
Now, let me ask you something, Dr. Greyson. Just exactly what is a near-death experience?
A near-death experience, or NDE, is a profound experience that many people have when they're on the threshold of death or are in fact pronounced dead and then revived. Most studies show that about a third of people who come close to death have one of these NDEs.
Do you have to really be on the threshold of death, so to speak? I mean, do you really have to be near death to have one?
Well, it's always hard to tell how close you are to death at a given point. But many people have NDEs, or near-death experiences, when they aren't physiologically near death, but they think they're going to die. For example, if they're in a car accident and their hearts don't stop, but they feel as if they're going to die any second. And they may go on to have a full-blown near-death experience at that point.
And what kind of people have a near-death experience? And is it a hallucination, or is it some type of mental illness, or just exactly how is it termed?
Mm-hmm. Well, anybody can have a near-death experience. Children, adults, people of all race, gender, age, have the same types of near-death experiences. There doesn't seem to be any effect of any of the usual demographic features. Your religious background, your belief system, your cultural upbringing do not affect whether you're going to have an NDE or what type you're going to have if you have one.
And how does the near-death experience affect the people after they have them? Is there a significant change? I mean, I've heard that some people have a whole new religious outlook or experience too.
That's right. As a psychiatrist, the most interesting part of this experience for me is how it changes people afterwards. I've talked to people 70, 80 years after their near-death experience who say that their lives have never been the same. You typically hear people saying that they are more spiritual after the NDE, not necessarily more religious, but more in touch with the spiritual side of life. Mm-hmm. They become universally no longer afraid of dying. They usually become less involved in materialistic things, more altruistic, less competitive. And these can, although they may sound like nice changes, they can really wreak havoc in someone's life if their life mm-hmm. was based on some of these things beforehand.
Mm-hmm. It sounds to me like, by what you're saying, that hypothetically a person that might have been very materially minded now sees that not so prominent in one's life.
That's right. And as I said, it can be very troublesome. For example, mm-hmm. if you are in a very competitive business mm-hmm. and then you come back from a near-death experience feeling like competition is not something you want to value anymore, that can ruin
your life.
Or if you're involved in a violent occupation, if you're a policeman mm-hmm. or a soldier, and you come back from the NDE feeling you can't engage in violence anymore, that's the end of your career.
Are all the near-death experiences, or those that you yourself have dealt with, are they always pleasant? I mean, are there some that can be termed hellish or...
Well, there certainly are some unpleasant ones, but they're in the small minority. It's actually hard to tell how many there are because it's very hard to talk about these experiences. It's hard enough to talk about the pleasant, positive, typical ones. And people who have the unpleasant, the so-called hellish experiences, are often much more reluctant to talk about them. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to say how common they are, but most guesses are it's around 1% of near-death experiences are unpleasant.
Mm-hmm. Well, the hellish ones with a near-death experience, does the person, is that particular person one who may have tried to commit suicide? I mean, what type of near-death experience does this denote that you're speaking of?
Well, it doesn't particularly happen to people who attempt suicide. People who make suicide attempts, generally speaking, have the same types of NDEs as people who have heart attacks or car accidents. Mm-hmm. It also does not seem to be the case that people who are, quote, bad have unpleasant near-death experiences.
Then would it be feasible for me to say and think that perhaps it's because it's related to a traumatic situation where maybe one is not prepared oneself for death?
Not necessarily. With some exceptions, it's hard to say what type of an NDE someone's going to have. Mm-hmm. One of the exceptions is that a large number of people who are undergoing anesthesia, particularly with ether, tend to have a certain type of unpleasant, frightening experience. Mm. And that may be an indication that this experience is more due to the anesthetic itself than to the NDE. But generally speaking, there's no way to predict who's going to have a pleasant or an unpleasant experience. Mm-hmm. And in fact, people who have had more than one NDE may have a very hellish one time and a beautiful heavenly one the next time.
So you can have more than one?
Oh, yes.
Do you always recall them?
Well, our studies show that a third of all near-death experiences lead to NDEs. But what that may mean is that only one third lead you to remember the NDE. Mm-hmm. It may be that every time you come close to death, you have one, but only a third of the time you remember them.
Mm. I see. How does the medical profession or the scientist or both regard this experience? Well, how do they view it?
I think we've seen a large change, a progression in the medical and scientific approach to NDEs over the past 10 or 15 years. When we first started looking into these experiences back in the mid-70s, a lot of medical people and scientists were appropriately skeptical about this. They hadn't heard about them before. Certainly they'd been written up in the religious literature of all ages, but the scientific literature had nothing about them. So a lot of people were skeptical, thinking that these were very rare experiences if they occurred at all. But in the last 10 or 15 years, there's been so much publicity about these experiences and so much written in the medical literature about them that there's no longer any question about whether they exist or not. There is some question, though, about what causes these experiences. Mm-hmm. And I think the medical profession is still divided appropriately about what's the ultimate meaning or what's the cause of these experiences. But we do see that more and more doctors, and particularly nurses, are accepting these as profound events that happen to their mm-hmm. patients. And that they want to know about so they can help the patients deal with them.
I see. Well, because of the publicity, I'm assuming that, of course, more and more people are coming forward and wanting to report. Now, what is available to these kinds of persons who claim these experiences? I mean, is there a support group? Is there somewhere that they can go? Mm-hmm. I mean, not everybody knows that Dr. Greyson is available. So is there a support group? And could you tell our viewers about that?
Yes, there's an international organization with its headquarters in Hartford, Connecticut. Mm-hmm. Called the International Association for Near-Death Studies, or mm-hmm. IANS. Mm-hmm. And this organization is located at 638 Prospect Street in Hartford, Connecticut, 06105. Their number is area code 203-232-4825. Mm-hmm. And among other things, this organization sponsors local support groups all over the world.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And there are mm-hmm. some 50 of those in the United States alone. Mm-hmm. I don't know where the listeners are coming from in this show, but there may be three or four within the sound of where we're reaching right now.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear. By what you said earlier in the program, that the type of changes that occur, it would just seem that there's got to be somewhere where they can go and not feel as though they're isolated or totally unacceptable, you know, by persons who maybe think this is all... you know, in someone's
right.
mind. And
that's
why
right,
I asked
Pat.
You about
yes.
the hallucinations. So I think that that's wonderful.
In fact, the support groups are important not only for the experiencer, him or herself, mm-hmm. but also for their family and mm-hmm. friends who may not understand what's happened and want to get a different perspective on it.
Now, you know I'm going to ask you this question on behalf of my own curiosity and that of my viewers. What got you involved? I mean, did you have a near-death experience yourself? I mean, what prompted this interest from you?
Well, I haven't had one yet.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, although I'm convinced from everything I've known that sooner or later everyone will have one of these mm-hmm. experiences. But it was sort of a matter of being in the right place at the right time. I was teaching at the University of Virginia when Raymond Moody, who wrote the book Life After Life that started all this, mm-hmm. Came through the program there in psychiatry. And once I was exposed to his book and the idea of near-death experiences, it became something that was hard to put down. Because this is an experience that in the flash of an eye can change a person forever. And in psychiatry, we work for long sessions with patients trying to provide very small incremental changes. So if we could figure out what is it about this experience that makes people change, we could tap into a very powerful force mm-hmm. for change.
What about the endorphins? Does that have anything to do? I know we just found out through science is always changing, and I know that even with our medical profession, that there's always new insight. Mm. And what about, I know for many years ago, we always thought that the body was put into shock, so to speak.
Right.
Now we're finding out that the brain actually protects the body by emitting these endorphins and puts the body into some sort of protective mode.
Right.
Could this possibly be happening and probably attribute to one thinking they're having an NDE when maybe the endorphins are just trying to comfort and maybe give them this pleasant feeling of, like with the religious connotation, that's what I want to get to actually.
Right. Well, endorphins may well be involved in NDEs. I don't think it's an either endorphins or a spiritual
mm-hmm.
experience.
Mm-hmm.
There have been a number of simple-minded or simplistic theories put forward to explain the NDE that just don't hold water. For example, the idea that this is lack of oxygen to the brain. We know what oxygen deprivation does, and it doesn't do an NDE.
Mm-hmm.
But the endorphin theory is one of those that may, in fact, have some bearing on the NDE. Endorphins are morphine-like chemicals which are produced in the brain in times of stress, such as during a near-death event. And they do produce a sense of euphoria or well-being, a sense of painlessness, and they do, in fact, stimulate the lobes of the brain where memories are stored. So it could be involved in the life review that is often part of the NDE.
Uh-huh. Yeah, of persons, they talk about going through the tunnel and seeing the light. You said earlier that even children, okay, if children can have an NDE, how would they, say children that really can't articulate yet or can't verbalize, say like a two-year-old or a three-year-old, what would happen then? What would indicate to you if a three-year-old child was having an NDE?
Well, very often children's behavior is changed mm-hmm. after the near-death experience. And if they are too young to really talk coherently about it, we often have them try to draw pictures of what happened to them or act it out in some way.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, there was an article published in one of the medical journals a few years ago about a six-month-old infant who was pronounced dead on the operating table having a kidney operation. And her behavior changed after that experience, but of course she was too young to talk about it. But 3 years later, when her grandmother was dying, when she was now 3.5 years old, she spontaneously recounted her near-death experience and related to the grandmother's dying.
That's incredible. What about children then through other expressive means? Children that say 6, 7, or 8 years old. Could they do it through drawings or any other kind of expression?
Mm-hmm. Yes, in fact, Melvin Morse, who is a pediatrician in Seattle, Washington, has a large collection of children's drawings about their near-death experiences.
This is a very fascinating field, Dr. Greyson. Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in with me, your host, Pat Gagliardo, here on Television 26, live on Insight. We're now going to take a word and listen to our sponsors, and then we'll be right back. So don't change that dial. And when we come back, you can then call in and you can ask Dr. Greyson yourself if you have some, if you've had an experience or you know someone that did, or if you know someone in your life that may be going through some changes that you don't understand, this is the place to call. Stay tuned and we'll be right back. Thank you. Welcome back. And for those of you who may have just tuned in, you are watching Insight, and I am your host, Pat Gagliardo, along with my guest this evening, Dr. Bruce Greyson. And we are talking about near-death experiences. And if you would like to speak with Dr. Greyson, please call us. And in Connecticut, it's 1-800-443-TV26. Calling out of state, the number to telephone is 203-444-2626. And now let's go right to the phones. Go ahead, Laurie from East Haddam. You're on.
You kind of touched on what I had called about. It happened on your program, never saw it before, and thought, gee, I always wanted to ask somebody this. As a young child, I mean, I was told all my life that as a young child or toddler, infant, I don't know which, I had had a near-death, I mean, I almost died. And when you listed the personality traits of people, I thought, gee, he's talking about me. And the funny thing of it is, I grew up always being very spiritual and different than everybody in my family, which was a very large family. And I always wondered why, and why did I know for sure there was a God? Jesus was as real as a person who held my hand, because my mother had died when I was little, and I always told people I was never alone. Do you think it's possible I could be unaware that I did have a near-death experience, yet I have all this? I'm 52 years old now.
It certainly is possible. Many people have a near-death event and then change without being able to remember concretely any of the details of a near-death experience. Do you remember anything about that event yourself?
No, just that my dad used to tell me that I almost died from croup, and that at the very last, they came and gave me the last rites of the church, a Catholic, I was a Catholic, and he said, but then suddenly somebody happened to know, and this is sound like I'm making it up, but he said a doctor named Dr. Blessing came, and whatever he did to me, that I rallied and I lived. And, you know, I never really talked about it, except, you know, I thought a lot about it here and there, not about a death, near-death experience, but why was I always different than everybody? People didn't understand when I'd self-tell them about God and say, but you don't understand. It's not just something you read about. This is real. He's real.
Yeah.
And I don't know how I know that. I just know that I have always known that. I became aware of knowing these things since I was maybe six.
And I imagine that when you were 6 years old, if you had started to talk about this, people would have just brushed it off because people didn't know about it back then.
Right. And the fact that's when my mother died, when I was that age, and there were other traumas and tragedies and things that happened in our lives, and I was put in an orphanage about a year later and grew up there. But I was as happy as a magpie there. I loved it. And when I had to leave that place, I hated the world and the way it was, because they claimed to be the same religion as me and live like me, but no one understood me, and I couldn't figure out what kind of God they were serving.
Well, Laurie, it sounds like you may want to get in touch with Eons, I-A-N-D-S, and of course, you know, you can write to me in care of Insight at the address that was given a few moments earlier.
Yeah.
So we thank you very much for your call, and we hope to hear from you.
Hey, thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you very Bye. Much. Have a nice evening. Go ahead, Tom from West Hartford, you're on the line.
Thank you, Dr. Greyson. I assume you're familiar with Dr. Kenneth Ring's latest book, The Omega Project.
Yes, yes.
And I read that recently, and I wonder if, what you think about, or do you agree with his what he says about the possibility of a relationship between that and the abduction experience. Mm.
Well, for those who haven't read Ken Ring's book, Ken Ring is one of the pioneers of near-death studies, and has been examining this area for about 10 or 15 years now, and has written two excellent books on the near-death experience. But as Tom mentioned, his most recent book looks at UFO abductions and near-death experiences, and basically looks at the after effects of those two experiences. And he finds that a lot of the characteristic changes you see after an NDE also occur after UFO abductions. I don't think he draws any similarity between the experiences itself, but the after effects are very profound. And the implication, one of the implications may be that
some sort of correlation.
The NDE and the UFO abduction may be two metaphors for the same type of experience. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for your call, Tom.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Ann from Jewett City, you're on the line.
Yeah, hi. I wanted to find out. I had a near experience. My father has passed away. He's been dead for quite a while. And I was under anesthesia, and I heard the doctors in the background say, we're losing her. And I seen my father, his vision of my father in the distance, and I was reaching out for him. And he was like moving far away from me, like he didn't want to come towards me. And the thing has been bothering me now for a while. I wanted to know, what did that mean? You know, did it mean anything? Or I have no idea. It's just been bothering me for a long time.
It's very common for people in a near-death experience to come upon deceased relatives, deceased loved ones. And sometimes these people are there as more or less guides to the other realm, but often they're also there to tell you that it's not your time, that you need to come back. And many people have told me that they wanted very much to stay in that other realm, but their deceased father or mother or relative told them that they had to come back to this life and finish some type of work. It sounds like you didn't get quite to that point where your father said anything to you.
No, I seen him in a distance. I seen his crew cut when he had passed away, and I seen him, and I mean, I didn't see his face or anything like that, but I seen him, and I kept putting my hands out to him, and he just kept moving away from me, and mm-hmm. I kept wanting to go close to him, and he just kept moving further and further away. And it seemed like when I'm looking at TV now, I see like the clouds and everything, and that's exactly what it seemed like up there.
And thank you so very much for your call. We do have to hurry along. Remember, you can get back in touch with Dr. Greyson via Insight. So thank you very much for calling.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Jim from Norwich.
Yes, I'd like to ask the doctor a question.
Sure.
Are there, quote, unquote, bright tunnels, as they say when they have near-death experiences?
I'm not sure I understood the question. Can you say the question again?
All right. I understand that people, when they have near-death experiences, they say they go through a tunnel, and at the end of the tunnel,
yes,
there's a bright light.
Right.
Is every near-death experience like that, or are they different ones?
Well, not every near-death experience is like that. Many of them do have a tunnel-like part to them. But although people from all over the world will talk about this tunnel-like experience, they'll describe it in different words, depending on what their cultural background is. For example, they will say a tunnel, a cave, a well. But many, many NDEs have some type of tunnel as a bridge between this world and the next world in them.
Thank you very much for your call, Jim, and have a pleasant evening.
Good
Ladies and
you.
Gentlemen, please stay tuned to Insight. I am your host, Pat Gagliardo. And as soon as we hear a word from our sponsors, we'll be right back. Thank you. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. You can now, for the remainder of the show, direct all your questions to me. And remember, if the lines are busy, just keep trying. And also, remember as well to continue to write to me. Remember to include a photo, a self-addressed stamped envelope. The address to write to me is Insight, Post Office Box 425, Jewett City, Connecticut, 06351. I am enjoying the mail, and thank you so much for your wonderful compliments and your support. So now, without any further ado, I'll go straight to the lines and answer your questions. Go ahead, caller.
Hi. I'd like to know what you see in relation to a career for me.
Okay. Is this something you've been contemplating making a change probably in the last year and a half or so, but kept it on the back burner?
Yes.
And are you doing something now where you deal with people I'm feeling sometimes in the background and then sometimes either directly with a telephone or something that needs for you to give it attention. I don't know if I'm putting in the words for you to understand me, but if that's something you're doing presently, then you'll probably continue with some expansion. But my impressions are, I'm not getting a change for you right away, but I do want to prepare you for something around the summertime. I don't know if it's something you're waiting for, but remember the months of July and August, okay?
So nothing until then.
Well, it won't come to pass. We won't be solid until then. If you get it before then, you'll just be getting your feet wet.
Okay.
I'm getting you really engrossed in July or August.
Okay, thank you.
Okay? Okay, thank you. Go ahead, caller from Lebanon.
Hello.
Good evening.
Yes. I'd like to have your feelings on my job opportunities coming up. I worked with the aircraft industry.
Mm-hmm. And you're concerned about longevity, you're concerned about position, you're concerned about where you're going to be.
Right.
And
exactly.
My mind tells me that you've been employed there for some time, that you're, I don't take this facetiously, and certainly that I'm not feeling, but I feel like you're part of the fixtures, meaning you've been there a long time. So rather than see you completely out of work, I do find that they may move you around a bit. You've probably had that happen already. Some external changes, maybe not directly affected you at this point, but will. And then toward the fall and into the winter time again, then I'm sensing a little more stability. Then a little bit later, maybe a month or two later, some uncertainty again. I don't see we have anything to worry about in this year, but toward the late part of the year, the winter months again, and into the first quarter of the new year, then I am sensing some other changes for you. So try not to be so concerned right now, and the stress is not good for you.
Well,
your health is a concern to me, too. I'm surprised that you're even calling, because you're usually not the kind of person to to verbalize what you feel. It'll come out in your actions, but you don't really talk that much about what troubles you. So I'm surprised about the call, but then again, I'm also understanding your fear. So hang on, sir, until, as I said, more toward the late part of the year into the first part of the new year. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, and good night.
Good night.
Go ahead, caller from Norwich.
Yeah, so I'd like to know if I just found out about a new life that I have inside mm-hmm. of me, and I'd like to know how well is it going to go.
Mm-hmm. Well, I sense that you had apprehension from a previous situation, and maybe a little bit now in this one. But I'm feeling more optimism myself, so I want to tell you that I'm optimistic and I'm feeling okay. Don't overdo and keep your emotions balanced. You're an extremist sometimes. You're hyper. You can get very excitable, and I'd like to see you do something to keep that even keel, so to speak. So good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for calling. Okay, caller from Jewett City, go ahead.
Yes, I have a question about my son. He's going through a trying time now. He's falsely accused of doing something.
Something, mm-hmm.
And I would like to know if and when they're going to find out who really did it or how long this is going to take to get
Well, it's going to be a while. My mind tells me it's already been dragging for some time. I don't feel a lot of negativity from the outcome, meaning I don't feel that, you know, he'll be scathed for life. I'm thinking that this will be an experience you probably won't soon forget, but I'm not getting a lot of negativity from this. So I don't think I'd be too alarmed if I were you. Right now, everything seems to be filled with uncertainty, but, and it may carry over into the end of the spring into summertime, so be prepared for that and exercise some patience between now and then. But end result, the end analysis, I feel, will be okay. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and good luck to you. Go ahead, caller from Stores.
Hi, how are you?
Good evening, sir. Go ahead.
Do you see any financial or occupational improvement for me in the near future?
Could you speak up, sir? I can just about hear you.
Okay.
Thank you.
See any financial or occupational improvement for me in the near future?
Something's being worked on already, I feel. I don't know if this is something you've implemented or something that you've applied for and you're kind of waiting. But to answer you, absolutely. Right away, my mind said yes. I mean, just like that. No hesitation, nothing. So yes,
really?
To answer your question, and probably soon, meaning look for it right around the corner, anytime, basically. And I'm glad for you because you've been very unsettled. It's like the niche hasn't been filled, and I sense in you antsiness. So I'm glad that this is happening because I'd have to say for the last 2 years or maybe even more, you haven't been what I would feel, what I would like to say, feeling content. My mind says no. Basically kind of riding the tide and always teeter-tottering because you haven't been fulfill, but with the changes coming, yes, even though it may require a more responsibility and even more mobility, don't worry about it. You'll be fine.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thank you for calling, and thank you for tuning in.
Okay.
Go ahead, caller from Vernon.
Hi, I would like to know if you could be able to tell me how and when I might be with my boyfriend, how he's going to get free from the place he's at.
Well, it's funny you said that, get free to me, because my mind said confined, too, and unable to be in your company. And unfortunately, I don't see anything in the immediate future. Now, this confinement, I don't know if it has to do with security in any way, but security came to my mind.
Yes.
And it's like he's not holding the answers. Somebody else is. And it's almost like it's up to them. That's what I'm feeling. So that being the case, I'd like to tell you it soon. I can't do that in all good conscience because I'm feeling later.
Right.
And it may not even be the end of this year. We could be looking within a 2-year time frame. So I have to tell you that. So unfortunately, I'm sorry, but I have to answer it as honestly as I can via impression. So keep praying and just bide your time and have some diversions in your life that are helpful for you, things that you can be doing for yourself, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Go ahead, caller from New London.
Hi, Pat.
Good evening.
I want to thank you for the show.
Thank you very much.
Do you think I will ever have a weight problem?
Well, do I think you'll ever have a what?
Weight problem.
A weight problem?
Yes.
Hmm. Well, I'm a little, I think I'm a little befuddled by your question because normally when that question is put to me, it's persons who have a weight problem and are trying to take weight off, and that's not what I felt from you.
Right.
I think what I felt from you is, do you want to put on weight? It's just totally the opposite. I don't even know why you're asking the question. I don't feel a weight problem from you.
Okay.
If anything, as I said, it's totally the opposite, but you're very obviously, you're very aware of it. And as long as you stay aware and stay in tune, so to speak, I don't think so, because it's now it's inside of your head. It's like it's a, you know, a way of life for you. So I think I could say, knowing what I feel from you, this inner strength or that want and that desire not to have a weight problem, I think you'll be fine.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for calling.
Okay.
Go ahead, caller from Norwich.
Yes, hello, Pat.
Good evening.
I enjoy your program very much.
Thank
you
very
much. I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
I have been very lonely.
Okay, one.
Do I see anything better in the future? And also, what do you foresee in my health?
Well, I'm going to let me go with the first question. As far as a commitment or somebody in your life long term, I'm going to have to say not in the immediate future. I don't sense, actually, if I could be so bold, half of you wants it, the other half of you doesn't. It's almost like you're now, you're kind of set in your ways. I think you want a companion, but I don't think you're ready to give up totally all your freedom. So knowing that I feel that from you, I'd have to say probably within the next year, no, as far as a committed relationship. Friendship, companionship, probably late summer, fall time, and it may not even be this year. I may not feel that until 1994, even into 95. But your health is somewhat of a concern to me. Not that I felt anything life-threatening or, an immediate or a pending dangerous situation or a life-threatening situation, but I keep getting the feeling that something needs to be monitored or looked at periodically. Or kept in check, so to speak.
Yes.
It's nothing serious. It could even be like a blood pressure or something in the blood. I'm not a doctor or diagnostician. I can only go with what my impressions tell me, but you're all right. You need to be concerned about good nutrition. That goes along with your health situation and exercise. I feel like you've got to get those kind of balanced out for yourself. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, Pat.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your compliments. Go ahead, caller from Norwich.
Yes. Could you tell me if I would stay with my old love or be joined with another new love?
I had difficulty in hearing you, caller.
I'll repeat it again. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Could you tell me if I'll be rejuvenated with my old love or find a new love?
You said rejoined with an old love?
Yes.
Well, honestly, the impression that I felt about that is not very comforting to me. For some reason, I felt that whatever the problems were that caused this to be an old love still exist. For some reason, I just am not comfortable with communication, with talk of desires and expectations. So I still find the same problems existing. So I'd have to say that old love situation will probably remain that way. Also, I keep getting another influence, so there may be another person involved. That being the case, I doubt if that's going to go anywhere on a committed level. So, and you've got to work through this. As long as you have this feeling of indifference, you're not going to be able to put yourself in a relationship that's going to require a lot of time, energy, effort, and a willingness, because you can't do that right now. So try and work through this other situation first. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Good night. Go ahead, caller from Lebanon.
Good evening, Pat. Thank
Good
you
evening.
For taking my call. We are in a situation where I am working, but I'm underemployed.
Mm-hmm.
My husband is unemployed. Do you see anything, hopefully something good coming in the future?
Hmm. He's unemployed at the present time?
Yes, he is.
Okay, what happened in the month of April, or why is the month of April so prominent here? What does that denote or depict? Is that something important? Is it significant?
Next month or
I don't know. I don't know if it's something that's already, but the month of April, all of a sudden, very strong in my mind. I don't know if it was last year in April that the troubles began, or if, in fact, this April there's going to be a significant change. But the month of April shows me change. But unfortunately, even with the change, I can't say it's really real for any long term. For some reason, I feel some change, some reprieve, some change, but temporary. So you may find that for the remainder of 1993, still to be not quite settled for you.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to, some other situations will arise again in the fall, some other decisions that have to be made. I must ask you, does your home sit up on a hill?
No, it doesn't.
Okay, who is close in the family that there is a store, like a commercial store, only one, and there's an access highway road. I go down and the road kind of veers, it kind of forks, and I slightly go uphill, and the house sits like up on a knoll.
Oh, I'm thinking.
For some reason, there is ill health connected here. And I want to tell you about it. I'm getting the strong impression of it being either someone in the family or it's someone like a friend, close. It's got to be someone close. It's not someone that's just, I don't think you can think right now because your mind's probably running.
Is it in the country or the city?
I'm sorry?
Was it in the country or the city?
It gives me sort of like a country-ish setting,
uh-huh.
Outskirts. Definitely not in town, no. Because I get like an access highway road, one sort of public outlet or something, some sort of store. I go down the access highway road, and then there's another road that branches off. It goes slightly uphill. The house, it sits up on a knoll and has like a stone wall or a rock formation to one side. I know it'll come to you, but that's okay. In any event, remember what I'm telling you. Okay?
All right.
Because I'm picking it up, I'm certain, probably precognitively, so you won't know until the time comes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and good luck, caller.
Thank you.
Okay, good night. Go ahead, caller from New London.
Yes, hi, Pat.
Good evening.
Good evening. I'd like to know whether or not you feel that my wife and I are going to have children within the next year. We've been married for 6 years now, and no kids yet, and we'd really like to start a family, but things just haven't happened.
Not yet. Which of you likes to go up to the mountains?
Oh, both of us.
Oh, good. Okay. Come the springtime. Oh, I don't know, maybe toward the end of May, early June. Get up to the mountains. Both of you like it up there. It's serene, very calming, and very nice and inviting. I do feel children. I can't say to you, yes, this year, but do I sense them within the next two, perhaps 2.5 years? Yes. Now, which of you has something to do with education, or why does books play a role here?
Books.
A lot of books. A lot of writing of little numbers and keeping logs.
Oh, that's me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I have to expound on that then. I'm sorry. I know you asked a question, but I have to go with what the energy tells me as well. Something is going on about changes, expansion, believe it or not. And that's probably good news, maybe not because you don't want to be as busy, but with the economic depressions in the rest of the country, this should be good news to you.
Yeah.
I do find that late spring and summer as well, you'll need that trip up north to the mountains because of the busyness of the workload. You also have a job that's very demanding. It's almost like there's not enough hours in the day to carry your workload.
Yes.
So that being the case, you'll welcome that reprieve. You'll welcome that time away. So go for it and have a good time and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for calling. Go ahead, caller from New London.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Hi. I was just wondering, I have strong feelings for a guy that I know, and everyone's telling me to pursue him, and I just wondered if that's something that I should do.
I'm going to disagree. For some reason, I'm not getting the response from this gentleman. And I don't think you're in a position right now to face, I don't want to say real rejection, but uncertainty right now, because your confidence level isn't where it should be either, mm-hmm. and not just because of this individual, your life on a whole. Mm-hmm. That being the case, do some things to, you know, work on optimism and maybe some, anything that's like with self-help and building your own esteem and confidence, etc. But with this gentleman, I don't think so. For some reason, I just feel that there's not that return, there's not that response. And I think you feel it too. And if that's the case, just be patient. You'll see that by the end of summer into the fall time of the year, things will turn around for you on their own. You won't have to go in pursuit.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for calling. Okay, go ahead, caller from Waterford.
Hi, I've been sick for a while now, and I'm wondering what you could tell me about my health.
Were cultures done? Is there any reason I feel something taken, looked at, and...
A lot of blood tests have been
okay,
done.
Okay. But nothing, yeah, but see, even with that, I'm finding, like, process of elimination and not really keying into what's going on. What I get from you is like a debilitation of your energy.
Exactly.
Like no strength.
Right.
I don't feel like limbs are hurt, you know, broken or, I just feel no strength, no energy. It's like there's no get up and go.
That's exactly.
And it may be that there is a parasite, there's some other, something that's going on that's being overlooked. Again, I'm not a doctor or diagnostician, and I don't want to sound like that. I don't want you to give up, you know, seeking out physician's help, of course, but you might want to also consider some alternative medical treatment as well, maybe even something along the lines of better nutrition, maybe through holistic measures, working in conjunction with. There's a reason why you're always debilitated, and I don't think you eat very well. I'm going to tell you that honestly. I don't think you have proper nutrition. You don't rest well either. So a lot of these things play an important role. So what you need to do is kind of look at something where you can be totally balanced.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It will get better. I will tell you that. I do not see this for the duration of your life,
mm-hmm.
but it's going to take even more time.
How much time would you, see that right now?
Well, I know it's been dragging on already long enough. You're probably saying, Pat, I've had it up to here already.
Yeah.
But, well, I'd have to say probably within 93, 94. Okay?
Oh, okay?
Between now and maybe this time next year.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, and remember what I said about nutrition. Please don't take that lightly.
Okay.
It does play such an important role. It really, really does.
Well, they think it's chronic fatigue syndrome.
I'm sorry?
They think it's chronic fatigue syndrome.
Whatever that may be.
Okay.
Well, good luck to you, caller, and thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Go ahead, caller from Canterbury.
Yes, I'd like to know if the relationship I'm in will succeed in a career that I was looking at, or should I look for employment locally?
Would this require a lot of travel for you?
Yes.
Well, I'm going to tell you something, though. That's right up your alley. You're not a sit-behind-the-desk 9-to-5 person. I can tell you that just by the energy that I feel from you. I'm not saying you couldn't do it, but you possess a lot of, mental power. It's like you get antsy. I think the more mobility, the more freedom of mobility would be better for you. So if it's like broadening your horizon, so to speak, I think it would be okay to make the change. I'm pretty confident and comfortable for you about the change. And the month of June, very strong to me. I don't know what that depicts for you. Again, it could be a birth date. I don't know. But June, also very strong. So with the changes, welcome them and be optimistic about it because you'll be all right.
But do you think the relationship I'm in will...
I think it will probably ride the tide, mellow out until maybe when you're secure in what you're doing and where you're going to be, that you may want to make changes in the relationship. Okay?
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Good night.
Okay, go ahead, caller from East Haddam.
Yes, I was wondering what you saw in my future for marriage and children.
Well, is there a reason I already sense something being planned or something discussed? because I feel like within a two-year time frame, your life, your status to be changed. So I don't know if that means there's already an involvement or there will be one, and in that time frame, that'll all come and work out for you. As far as children go, let me hear from you later down the road, because as you see, I like to give specifics. I don't want to give generalities, and I could say to you, sure, you're going to have children, but I don't see them for you in that time frame of, say, a year or 18 months. So just be patient. Take one step at a time. Go through the marriage and everything first.
Okay, so you're saying marriage in probably 2 years?
Within that time frame, two and a half years at most.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all of you.